All right, just want to welcome everybody here. Thank you all for coming out to this noon Good Friday service. I appreciate all of you taking time out of your noon hour, your lunch hour maybe, and just to be here to celebrate Jesus and, of course, his crucifixion. Many of you have your own Good Friday services tonight. We do here, and I know several of you do. But thank you for being here. Thank you, pastors, for saying yes to offering some words of encouragement on the seven last words of Christ. In your bulletin, I'm not going to announce you. Just come up when it says it's your turn to come up to the podium to speak. And for those of you that may not know every pastor here, you'll tell by the phrase that they use who that is. So anyway, I just want to say thank you. We want to honor the Lord this noon hour, and of course, always in our life. Let's stand for an opening word of prayer. We'll go into When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. The words are either in your hymnal or they'll be on the slides. Father, we come before you today just to honor our precious Savior. We just thank you for unity in Christ. We may disagree on a lot of things, but we're unified in you, Jesus. We come before you just to lift you up, that you would refresh us with words from your servants, words from songs, that we just celebrate you this weekend in a more profound way. We thank you, we honor you, we lift your name as we come this hour. In your name, Lord Jesus, amen. When I survey the wonders of God.
Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. And it is exciting to be here. Thank God. So I'm just starting out with those first words that you see in your bulletin, Luke 34. And actually, I'm just going to do the first three words of that sentence is, Father, forgive them. And forgiveness is a rather large, well, the example that Jesus set with the folks that are spitting on him, pulling out his beard, right, mocking him, nailing him, putting nails through his palm and through his feet. And he says, forgive them. So to talk about forgiveness and the depth of that and the fact that we have no limitations to put on that, meaning we can't say, well, yeah, but you don't know what they did to me. But just moving on from that concept and believing that, well, we know the intensity of forgiveness that Jesus exampled, I want to look at the word them real quick. When he's up there hanging on the cross and he says, Father, forgive them, who's he referring to? Well, I think one of the obvious ones would be the ones that we've already mentioned, the ones, you know, pulling out his beard, spitting on him, whipping him, beating him, the ones driving the nails through the palm of his hands, or the ones sitting there with glee and anticipation just watching him slowly die a miserable, painful, suffering death. I guess those people would be considered enemies, right? People that are not for you, people that are against you. And he says, Lord, forgive them. And I think one other thing to point out in this is that Jesus' whole time here, it's not just about what he did for us, but the fact that he set an example for us to follow. And so in that even, there's an example to follow, which I think Stephen did a perfect job of following when he was sharing the gospel with a group of people one time. And it says that he was sharing the truth. It's supposed to set them free. But instead, it cut them to the heart, and it says that they gnashed their teeth at him. And that's a good time when you look around and you make an exit plan. But they're gnashing their teeth, and it says that they pulled him out of the town and stoned him to death. And yet he says this as he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice and said, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. So we can follow that example of the Lord Jesus Christ, forgiving our enemies. Amen. But also, as he hung there and he looked out on the crowd, there was another group of people, probably the only other group of people in my mind, either your enemy or your friends. But the problem is he had friends out there that had betrayed him. And I think that's sometimes even harder than forgiving our enemies, because I think that word betray, first you have to open yourself up and have a friend. I mean, we're talking about friends here, family, co-workers, fellow ministers, someone that you actually confided trust into. That trust has to be established before you can be betrayed, right? So the other, when he says, Lord, forgive them, another group of them is the ones who have betrayed him. And again, as far as being an example to follow, Paul, I think, followed that up wonderful. I mean, when we say betray, you know, a lot of times our mind just tilts to Judas, which is kind of a given, but you also have Peter, right, that denied him three times. But really, in Matthew 26, it says, then all his disciples forsook him and fled. So really, in a very good sense, when Jesus was hanging there, he was hanging there alone. And all the people, when he just needed someone to look up and say, you can do this, you're going to make it, you're going through all the way, I don't think he could find anyone. They all betrayed him at that time. But anyhow, another one that followed then that example was Paul. We find Paul in 2 Timothy where when he came to the end of his course, and he says, my time of departure is at hand. I run my race. I finish my course. He still had a little bit to go through here yet, but you know, when you get to the end of it, that's when you hope, after you've given your life to this, to people, you've poured yourself out as a drink offering. Fellow ministers, think about it. Put in your 20 years, your 25 years, your 30 years. You get to the end of your race, and you're looking around, something comes up, and you're at a point where you just need someone. Not a body, someone, not a body as in multiple people, someone. You're just looking for someone to stand there, to be there, to encourage you, to finish this thing with you. And Paul says, in 2 Timothy 4:10, he says, for Demas has forsaken me. But then he goes down a little bit further, and he says, but all men have forsaken me. But then he says this, I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. So when you get to the end of your race and you think of all the people that you've put into, that you've loved, that you stayed up late for, all the hospital visitations, all the vacations that you canceled so you could be there for them, all the weddings that you did, when you get done with all your life and all you're pouring it out and you need one person to stand with you and you look around and there's no one, all those names that come to mind, that's who we forgive. We forgive our enemy, and we forgive those who've loved us and let us down or betrayed us in any fashion that way. And then the last thought is with Judas there. You know, it goes on to say that Judas, it says that he repented of himself, and he came and went to the scribes. And when Jesus said them, Judas was one of them. Amen? But Judas didn't receive it, because after he repented of himself, it said that he went out and he hung himself. So he obviously was trying to right a wrong, and you can't always right your wrong, but you can receive forgiveness no matter how bad the wrong is. So with that word forgiveness, I just see three thems: your enemy, your loved ones, and yourself. Amen.
So the next words that I will be sharing with you is can be found in Luke chapter 23 and verse 43, where Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." And as I studied this text and pondered over those words, there were a few things that really stood out to me. And the first thing that stood out to me was the fact that Jesus himself was hanging on the cross. He was inflicted with so much pain and suffering, yet he still thought enough of the criminal to speak words of hope to him. The next thing that really stood out to me in this text here was the person that Jesus appears to be talking to. The text tells us that it was a criminal. This was a man who was convicted of crimes and some of the most heinous crimes of their times, and he was punished with death. And it wasn't just any type of death. This was the death that was sentenced on those who had committed the worst crimes possible. He was to be crucified and nailed to the cross. And Jesus offers this convicted criminal, this man that was guilty of sin, the ultimate sign of hope. And Jesus tells him that, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." What this brought to me was the fact of how much love and mercy and forgiveness Jesus has for each and every one of us. No matter what we've been charged with, no matter what we've done, no matter what mistakes we made, Jesus is still saying to us, "Truly today, I offer you paradise." The next thing that really stood out to me about this text was the importance of confession. Okay, the criminal in this text that Jesus is talking to, he actually rebukes another criminal that was mocking Jesus, and he looks over to the other guy and he says, "You know what? You know, we are being, you know, punished for what we have done. You know, this punishment is just for us. This other guy, this Jesus guy, he hasn't done anything." And you know, in the Bible, in the Bible, excuse me, let me back up, sorry. In this text where Jesus, where this guy confesses his sins, he shows us the power that we have in Christ when we confess our sins. The Bible teaches us that if we confess our sins, that he will forgive us. The next thing I see in this text here was that this man, he didn't try to hide his sins. He didn't try to blame anyone else. He took responsibility for his actions. Many times we find ourselves in situations where it's easy to point the finger at someone else when the reality is the truth, when reality is the blame lies within us. And when we do confess our sins, Jesus will forgive us. The next thing that stood out to me was the power that I saw in faith, in the power of belief. In John 11, Jesus tells Martha, he says, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even though he died, will live." And then again in John 6 and 40, Jesus tells the people that followed him, he says, "For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them on the last day." And here we have in this text this convicted criminal, guilty of sin, demonstrating Christian-like faith and belief in Jesus, as he turns to Jesus and looks at him, and ask Jesus to remember him when he gets into his kingdom. It was at that moment when the scriptures really became true for this guy. And the same thing is for us. Sometimes it's not until we find ourselves in those really dire situations do we receive Jesus' love and those scriptures really come true for us. The last thing that really stood out to me in this text was that if we're not careful, it would be easy to assume that Jesus was only talking to this one convicted criminal on the cross. But the Bible tells us that we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But we also know that in Jesus' love and in his mercy toward us, he is still offering us an opportunity to spend paradise with him if we would simply believe in our heart and confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and confess our sins, then paradise awaits us as well. Amen.
Thirdly, as Jesus was on the cross, John 19:26, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. We're here today because Jesus loves you as an individual. Amen? You've heard his voice. He's forgiven you of sin. He loves you. He loves me. I get it. God loves the world, and he loves the church. But he also loves you as an individual. And he loves me. Jesus loves me. This I know. Jesus loves you as an individual. As William Barclay, the great scholar, put it, here is Jesus hanging on the cross with salvation in the balance, and he speaks to individuals, to the thief, to them, to his mother, and to his beloved disciple, John. Individuals. In these two phrases, I just want to unpack, as the 35-second shot clock is on now, three simple phrases that Jesus said from the cross to two individuals. First of all, he said, "Woman," referring to his mother. He didn't use say mother. Woman was a very endearing, affectionate term in those days. It sounds harsh to us. Sounds formal to us. But when you dig into some research, it was a very affectionate term. He used that term to refer to his mother in John 2 at the remember the water into wine. I wonder what Mary felt when she heard that. Did she even anticipate even being there that day? Did Jesus anticipate her being there? I wonder what she felt. You remember Mark Lowry's great song, Mary, Did You Know? Okay, it's a great song. I think Mary knew all along. What's going through her mind? Yes, I think she's looking at her Savior and Lord on the cross, but she's also looking at her boy dying. If you remember the Passion of the Christ, that great scene where Jesus is carrying his cross down the Via Dolorosa and Mary sees him, and then there's a flashback going back into her life as a mom and remembering the childhood memories. I mean, come on, folks, I've done 100 funerals or more, right, in my lifetime, and everybody, including doing a funeral for my mom, everybody goes back to your childhood. Nothing wrong with that. I think she did. She's seeing her boy. And so hearing that phrase, woman, I believe it brought healing, acknowledgement to her suffering and to her loneliness, and she was there. She did show up. That's awesome. Secondly, she said, woman, behold your son. I always thought that was a reference to look at me. Well, maybe some people do take it that way. I think he was saying, woman, behold your son now, John. In Jewish culture, it was the obligation of the eldest son to take care of the family. And Jesus knew, obviously, he was going to rise again and ascend, but he would not be around to take care of his mother. And so he's saying to John, and one scholar raised the point, why John? Why not his half-brothers? Because I don't think at this point the half-brothers had really come to grips with who he was. And so he's saying to John, take care of her. Behold your mother now. What an endearing word. What a prophetic word, if you will. And as most historians point out, he did take care of her until about 40 AD when she passed away. That's a whole nother story. And then this phrase, John, to an individual, behold your mother. I think of John, the apostle who lived the longest, perhaps dying as late as 90 AD, wrote 5 books in the New Testament. His first mission in life was to take care of her. Prophetic word to him. So as I started this message, I want to end this way. I was pastoring a church in the Portland, Oregon area, and one of the long-term members confided in me. I think he was afraid to share it much with other people, but he said, the turning point in my Christianity came when I heard the audible voice of God and the Lord called me by my name, by my formal name. He said it changed my life. I don't have a problem with people share testimonies like that. I've never heard the audible voice of God. But I think we've all been here today and we've heard the voice of the Lord in many ways in our life. And maybe today, as individuals, all of us need to hear Jesus say to us, I know you, I know your hurts, I hear your prayer requests, I know your needs, I am with you. You matter to Jesus as his mother and his beloved disciple mattered to him on the cross.
From the words of Matthew, chapter 27, verse 46. And Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? When Ross called, I honestly thought, why did you give me the hardest ones of the bunch? Jesus has long been portrayed as one that, in this moment, was weak and forsaken and felt forsaken. And yet, if you truly knew what he was saying, you knew that he was saying anything but. Jesus was bringing forward a message that had been long foretold way before Jesus was ever born. From Psalm 22, the first words are, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer, by night, but I do not find rest. When David was crying out to the Lord and couldn't find God, he expressed the anguish that many of us feel when we are lost, when we are empty, when we are poured out and have nothing else to live for. In verse 7, all who see me mock me. They hurl insults. They shake their heads. He trusts in the Lord. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. The same words of mockery that Jesus would hear at the cross. David says that dogs surround me. A pack of villains encircles me. They pierce my hands and feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat at me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garments. And yet, as Christ hangs on the cross, he repeats these words to us not out of despair, but out of his whole humanness, out of his whole divinity. He truly experiences what we experience so that we may know that God understands us, that God knows us, that God feels what we feel, that God shares in our pain and our angst. I will declare your name to my people in the assembly, and I will praise you, goes on the psalm. For he has not despised or scorned the suffering of afflicted ones. He has not hidden his face from him, but he has listened to his cry for help. Jesus is not just expressing that he is with us, but he is telling us, those that know, that there is hope, that he is not alone on this cross. He has not been vanquished. He has been accepted and loved. And no matter what we go through, he will stand with us. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. And may your hearts live forever. All ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him, for dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him. Those who cannot keep themselves alive, posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to all people yet unborn that he has done it. Jesus is not giving up hope. He's not forsaken by God. He's not alone. And to those who know this psalm's works, they too know that the prophecy has been fulfilled and the hope of the world is before them. God is with Christ. And Jesus has fulfilled the prophecies and fulfilled God's promise to us. Through that, a new covenant is being born. A promise is being told to us from the prophecies of old through the body of the new. Jesus, the Messiah, is truly here to show you and me that we are not alone, even in our deepest times of trial, but we are always with God, and God is always with us. Amen.
So you thought you had the hardest ones. I'm just going to grab this. Maybe. So you thought you had the hardest word, but I think it was, I got the hardest word because it's, I'm thirsty. I thought maybe it was Ross getting back to me for all those times I yelled at him on the basketball court when he was reffing my basketball games. We'll maybe cast that demon out in that sinful nature later. But I thought of this word, and I thought of running marathons, a few less pounds than I currently have, one less knee replacement that I have. I used to run marathons. And usually at the end of marathons, there's this large crowd that is cheering you on. You get to the end of the race and you can just hear the noise. As you're approaching a certain section, you hear this noise. And as you get closer to the finish line, the cheering gets louder and it gets louder. And most marathons, they have it set so you round a corner and there, the crowd just erupts. It doesn't matter who you are. They don't know you, but they're cheering you on. They're taking you to the finish line. They're carrying you to the finish line, and you can see it. At this point, you can see it, and you go, I've got this. I've finished. So you ground that corner, and you're screaming, and they're yelling, and you finish that race, and you're exhausted, and you're thirsty. And I thought of this as, that was maybe what Jesus was. He knew his time was close. When he was on that cross, and he was hanging there, and he says those words, I am thirsty. He knew he was about to finish. He knew he was about to cross that finish line that his Father had for him, his Father being God. He knows that, as Pastor Pat said, that prophecy spoke of who Jesus was, and that he was going to finish this race. He was going to finish this race, and all this prophecy was going to become true. And we know, all of us in this room, I'm sure we know, that Jesus, he's the Son of God. That Jesus is the Son of God, but Jesus, who is God, he's also sent to earth just for this moment of this time. In these words, I am thirsty, I think there's a couple things we can see from this. God, Jesus being God's Son, he sees these words figuratively saying, God, Father, I need only what you can give me. Saying, Father, I'm thirsty, but I'm not physically thirsty. I'm thirsty. I'm spiritually thirsty. I'm spiritually in need. I need you to comfort me with only that you can comfort me, just like he can comfort us. And Jesus was also demonstrating, because Jesus was human. He was fully human. He's showing the human side of him. He is expressing probably a human need. He's finishing this race. And as we think about this race, he's saying, I am thirsty. So he's expressing a human need that I think we all have. These simple words demonstrating to us that Jesus is God. Jesus is the Son of God. He is fully God, but he's also demonstrating to us that he's fully human. Listen to these words I'm using the translation, the Message, but I want you to listen to these words out of 1 Peter 2, 21 through 22. It says, this is the kind of life you've been invited into, the kind of life Christ lived. He suffered everything that came his was so you would know that it could be done. So Jesus, again, fully God, fully human, saying, I am thirsty. He's showing he's experienced everything in life, everything, even to the point of death. And he's inviting us all into this life with him. And this life, it's not always roses, is it? Sometimes there's suffering in this life. But he's showing, you can do it. I've done it. You can do it. So maybe I'll ask this question. Are you thirsty? Are you thirsty for this life that Jesus gave us on the cross?
Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. In Christ's final hours, so many people assumed that they had control over his life. Judas assumed that he could use Christ, take his freedom for financial gain, and so he handed Christ over to the temple guard, and the temple guard shackled him and committed him over to the religious leaders, who then committed him to Pontius Pilate, hoping that they might force Pilate's hand and have him executed. Well, Pilate, seeing the trap, committed him over to Herod. And Herod, after his curiosity and his penchant for violence was satisfied, sent him back to Pilate. In this charade of passing the buck, Pilate tried to commit the Messiah to the people. He gave him the choice. Jesus' freedom over Barabbas. Finally, backed into a corner, Pilate had Jesus committed to a cross on Calvary. And during this fiasco of who gets to determine Jesus' fate, those in power did everything they could to manipulate the system, to bend the laws in their favor, even to shirk responsibility. To a man, they were willing to use and abuse and even kill the Messiah for their own gain. And to a man, they thought that they had power over Christ's destiny, that his fate had been committed to them. But Jesus knew who he belonged to. He knew. And these men, tangled in the ugly affairs of their small world, they could shackle, they could beat, they could whip Jesus' physical body. They could even have a hand in causing his heart to stop beating. But not once were they operating outside of God's sovereignty. And so Jesus, he kept largely silent during the whole painful ordeal. Over and over again, those who held earthly sway implied that he should answer to them, for they had the power over his life, the power to take it. But our Jesus did not defend himself. He didn't speak up. He refused to surrender any part of his spirit to them. But there on that cross, as the sky grew dark and the earth shuddered at what was taking place, after the punishment, after the ridicule, after the public shaming of Christ, when the rulers of this world had their best shot at exerting power over Christ, he let the world know exactly who held sway over his spirit. In those final and blessed moments, our Jesus did surrender himself to the only one who was worthy of his submission. Father, into your hands I submit my spirit. Jesus took those words out of Psalm 35, verse 5. It says, into your hand I commit my spirit. You have ransomed me, O God of truth. Family, because Jesus committed his spirit to the Father, because he submitted to the perfect will of God on that awful, painful, beautiful day, you and I are also able to say, Father, you have ransomed our soul, and it's in your hands that we commit our spirit.
It is finished. So I want to go back to the Samaritan woman at the well. And most of us probably are familiar with it. He goes, he's alone with this woman from Samaria, right? It's a little scandalous as we talk about this. He He asks her for some water to drink. He has a conversation. He talks about living water. She's curious. Give me some of that water. He says, well, first, go get your husband. I don't have one. You're right in saying that you don't have one. As a matter of fact, you've had five husbands, and the one you're living with isn't your husband. Oh, I see you're a prophet. You think? Right? They start talking about true worship. They talk about worshiping in spirit and in truth. And she says, well, when the Messiah comes, in the moment of truth, I am he. I can't help but think, was Jesus thinking about that moment as he was hanging on the cross? There are so many beautiful pictures and moments of Jesus interacting with people. The joy of his work. Oh, think about the moment that he's encountering this woman, the life change, the excitement of working with people, and they get it and they see it, and the love of Christ connecting, the encounter, the change. I think Jesus was thinking about that moment. I think it's time for you and I to have more conversations around the well. Even as Jesus had conversations around the well. And the well really is the place of broken people. I want to read a passage in that story. Listen to this. It says, just then, after Jesus has this encounter with this woman, his disciples returned, and they were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, what do you want? Or why are you talking with her? No, they're just creating stories in their minds, I'm sure. Then leaving the water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ? And then they came out of the town and made their way towards them. And I was thinking about that. She says she left her jar there, the very reason she went to get water, and she forgot the jar. I got to tell you this. This wasn't planned, but I was thinking about this morning. When I gave my life to Christ, I was just before my 19th birthday. It was in the basement of a bank. I gave my life to Jesus. It was so powerful and so exciting. I ran to go tell, wasn't my wife at this, my wife now, but it was before we were married. I went to go tell Bernie. I ran downtown to go find my wife, and I keep thinking, why didn't I take my car? To this day, I don't know where my car was. She forgot her jar. There's something about encountering Jesus. There's something exciting and moving in our hearts. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, Rabbi, eat something. But he said to them, I have food to eat that you know nothing about. And the disciples said to each other, well, could somebody have brought him some food? Why didn't you think about packing that lunch? Or, you know, why didn't we buy those fish when we saw him at the bar? But he said to them, right, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. That's the food that feeds Jesus, to do his will and to finish his work. Do not say 4 months and more and then it's the harvest. I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Don't let the distractions keep you from ministry. They were so concerned about lunch, they missed what Jesus was engaging them with. It's called the harvest. He opened their eyes to the significance of the work of God. I want you to imagine this, if you would. The people from that Samaritan village are walking up maybe a hill or walking up the road or they're walking through the fields. There's at least dozens of them, if not hundreds of them. And I would imagine linen is probably the heat of the day. So they put the linen over their head and they cover their head with the linen cloth. And they're walking towards Jesus. And Jesus looks at his disciples and he says, look up and see the fields white for harvest. Does it not look like wheat in the field walking towards Jesus? Cast your eyes and look. Look up. It's now is the time. It's not in August. It's now. Jesus said this, I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. We bring glory to our Father by doing good works. We're the light of the world. Your good works bring glory to our Father in heaven. We have a work to do. We all need some sketchy friends. Jesus hung out with sketchy people. It's so easy to get into our church world. And my encouragement as we think about Jesus hanging on that cross is that you would hang out with some sketchy friends, unsaved friends, people that have questionable lifestyles. Can you and I capture the essence of what it means to say this? My food is to do the will of my Father and finish his work. The Apostle Paul, he didn't quit. He never gave up. He never gave in. He continued to the end by impacting the lives of those unsaved, sketchy friends. And he said this, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. And Jesus' last words, it says this later as he hung on the cross, fulfilling everything that these men talked about. When everything was complete and he knew it was finished, he said, it is finished. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.